It's been just over 2 weeks since we talked about Christmas traditions here on Old Fashioned AF Live, but you requested it, so here it is. An updated, much easier to watch and or listen to edition of my top Victorian Christmas traditions, along with a few I'd love to see make a comeback. Before we get started, we are oh so close, only $45 away, as of filming this video, to reach our fundraising goal of $1,000 for Make-A-Wish Foundation before Christmas Eve, before midnight on Christmas Eve. After this video, be sure to visit the link in the description and contribute, even if you can only spare a dollar or two, because I am so proud of us for making it this far, and I think we can push it over the edge. I'm counting on you, crafters. So let's start with a little historic context. For thousands of years, humans have celebrated the winter solstice, and as Christianity spread across the globe, many pagan traditions became intertwined with Christian celebrations. But there is one era in particular that stands out as having shaped the Christmas that we all know and love today, and that's the Victorian era. The Victorian era is defined, at least academically, as the time from which Queen Victoria began ruling the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Ireland in 1837 until her death in 1901. Over her time as queen, many societal changes took place, including many advances in science and industry, but next to the proliferation of domestic and commercial electricity and the invention of photography, and maybe the beginnings of modern medicine, there is arguably nothing more recognizable to us in the Western world today than that of the quintessential Victorian Christmas, am I right? Of course, the Brits do things slightly differently to those of us in the United States. So let's talk about some of the Victorian Christmas traditions that have endured on the other side of the pond first. Perhaps the most recognizable feature of the Victorian Christmas is that of the Christmas turkey, which remains popular in the UK to this day. The earliest records of British Christmas turkeys date back to the early 1500s, when turkeys were brand new imports to the British Isles, and thus very expensive and hard to come by. But Charles Dickens's A Christmas Carol further popularized the tradition, and by that point, turkeys were more widely available in the UK and so became the meal of choice for more of those imperialistic importing loving Brits than ever before. Though admittedly, mostly because of its cost, it wasn't really until after rationing ended in post-World War II UK when the bird really took off, so to speak, with it becoming the holiday meal of choice for most of the British. Then there's the Christmas cracker, which I am going to pull with Lawrence on tomorrow's video. Did I mention that tomorrow's video is the very last Vlogmas video of the year on Old Fashioned AF, and that we're finally going to try the Christmas cake? And that if you're a member of the Crafty Club, you already have access to that video a whole day before the rest of the internet. But I am getting ahead of myself. Let me get back on track. Back to Christmas crackers. The cracker seems to come in and out of fashion here in the United States, with a huge surge in its popularity during the British Soul Invasion, which as a Whovian, I like to call the invasion of the Doctor, of the late 2000s. By the way, thank you to those of you who gave me suggestions on where to find Christmas crackers for next year. Anyway, the Brits still seem to continue to embrace the tradition of pulling a cracker and reading a usually pretty crappy joke at mealtimes, and then spending a few minutes wondering why the little gifts inside are just so incredibly useless. I mean, look at this. I bet there's a piece missing. This tradition got its start at the height of the Christmas craze in the late 1840s, or maybe 1850s, by a London confectioner named Tom Smith, who initially sold them with bonbons inside before he decided that gifts were the better option. Who knows why? So that brings me to the beginnings of the Christmas craze itself, which got its start with a still very popular tradition around the world today, the Christmas tree. Despite popular conjecture, in the Tenenbaum in Britain did predate Queen Victoria by probably at least 40 years. But just like with the turkey, it was this sketch of the royal family that made the once fringe accessory a must for most Brits and Americans alike. I should also note that fake trees date back to the 1880s when Germany had a shortage, with the first fake trees being made out of wood and goose feathers that had been painted or dyed green. Well, thank goodness for that, because I was just really afraid that my old-fashioned card would be revoked, of course. And y'all didn't think that I actually read the comments, did ya? Speaking of Christmas trees, what made it to the United States, and which traditions didn't? For starters, the Christmas dinner in the USA is much more eclectic than that of the Brits. And many families opt for a whole gamut of different food choices, depending on their own dietary requirements or historic backgrounds. Popular dishes tend toward the snackier and to be on the sweeter side, and include anything from honey glazed ham to green bean casserole in Alabama to pork sliders and even to the turkey itself in Florida. Something else that changed quite substantially over the Victorian era was the act of giving gifts. Up until the Christmas craze, there was a tendency toward giving gifts on New Year's Day. But as Christmas celebrations gained more and more popularity, then more and more people began giving gifts at Christmas instead. In the early Victorian era, these gifts mostly consisted of small homemade goods like dolls or handkerchiefs, or richly preserved fruit or nuts that were so small that they could be hung on the tree. Hence the line, "And presents on the tree," in the song "Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas," which was clearly a throwback line even when it was written in 1944 for "Meet Me in St. Louis." But as the Victorian era progressed, Christmas consumerism fully took hold, with a substantial increase in opting for gifts of larger, more store-bought variety. To this day, people across the world open gifts on Christmas Day, and a great portion of the time, those gifts have been store-bought and wrapped, possibly even to be placed beneath the tree. Another popular tradition that still holds some weight in the United States, as well as in the UK, is the sending and receiving of Christmas cards. The first Christmas card is still perhaps one of my absolute favorites, and it's generally just reminding you to have a Happy New Year. Not all Victorian Christmas cards were as jovial as this one. In fact, many of them were darkly comical. You see, the Victorians had a sense of humor about Christmas and about death, which makes sense because penicillin hadn't been discovered yet, which means that there were a lot of types of ways that you could die from things that we nowadays just take for granted, like cuts on the hand from chopping up vegetables, for example. So what better way than to greet loved ones with a card depicting Krampus or the Yule Lads, both folkloric pagan creatures whose myths included doing terrible things to children during the Yuletide season, or a group of drunken birds with their hungry predator waiting quietly to strike. Ghost stories were also a popular pastime in the Victorian era, both in the USA and in the UK. And in the United States, at least, there was one sect of Christianity, spiritualism, that took these beliefs to a whole new level, with members claiming that they could sometimes commune directly with the dead. In fact, Charles Dickens himself was obsessed with the supernatural and grew up listening to some very gruesome tales told to him by his nanny, Miss Mercy. Another popular pastime in the Victorian era was, you guessed it, seances. Dickens flirted with spiritualism himself, and he loved a good seance, or rather to go and then to debunk whatever it was that whoever the hosts were trying to pawn off onto the unsuspecting guests. Personally, I think that some of these wilder, darker traditions should each make some kind of 21st century comeback, but in real 2020 fashion, It would have to either look like the workings of some mad conspiracy theory, or at least be held over FaceTime. Finally, the Victorian Christmas tradition of watching Doctor Who on Christmas Day is one that I personally miss. And before you go adding me and telling me that TVs didn't exist in the Victorian era, then how can you explain Queen Victoria's ongoing support of Torchwood for oh so long? In all seriousness, though, there really is a petition on change.org, and some of you actually signed it already, but I came across it accidentally while doing some research for this series of Vlogmas videos. So if you're interested in what the Brits refer to as the Christmas telly, then you can sign it, and I've linked it in the description below. I hope you enjoyed this, the second Victorian Christmas tradition video, and perhaps even learned a new thing or two as I shared some of the more entertaining aspects of the Victorian Christmas. If you just can't contain yourself for tomorrow's video, hop on over to the Crafty Club, become a member, and then you'll get to see me and Lawrence try a Christmas cake at least a day before the rest of the internet. As ever, I've linked it in the description. Otherwise, see you tomorrow for the final Vlogmas video of 2020.